Hello everyone again. We're back on our second video of Quantum Mechanics Done Right, the shortest path from novice to researcher. Today I'm going to show you how this book, which is forthcoming from Springer, compares with some of the other books that are more traditional books that are around. And I'm also going to tell you about the origin of where the idea for writing this book came from and why it took so long to get it completed. So it all started in 2017, really started in 2014 during the MOOC craze, when I decided I wanted to create a MOOC that would teach quantum mechanics to everyone. The MOOC is called Quantum Mechanics for Everyone. It was launched on edX in 2017. It had the remarkable aid and assistance of two very talented undergraduates. Dylan Cutler, shown here, you can see his graphic skills. He's currently a engineer at Google. And Lucas Vieira Barbosa, who was a visiting student from Brazil at the time we were working on this project, and he had a lot of experience in programming and animation for education. He has gone on to get his PhD, and I believe he's currently a postdoc working in quantum mechanics. This course was very well received. We taught over 20,000 students in a full year of offering the course. It now has reached well over 50,000 students. The course also received prizes and recognition. It was the finalist for the 2018 edX Prize. No, unfortunately, it did not win. I also was the finalist in another MOOC that I have, and no, that did not win either. So I have a lot of time being the bridesmaid, but never the bride. It's very highly rated. You can see here, if you look at Class Central's top 250 MOOCs of all time, we're sitting here at number 3 on the list. And if I can get a couple more of good reviews for it, we might even be able to move up higher on the list. After the course was completed, students immediately asked for the sequel. I told them, look, guys, I worked 3 years making this class. I don't have a sequel. But that actually got me to thinking, what is really needed to teach quantum mechanics? I was focused at this point on accessibility. I wanted to see what can I teach to people who just have a high school background in math and physics. And when I was discussing this, a colleague of mine, Wes Matthews, came to me and he told me about something called the factorization method. I had never heard of the factorization method, and I suspect many of you on this video have never heard of it either. There already are textbooks that have been taught using this method. There's this incredibly wonderful short textbook by Herbert Green called Matrix Mechanics. And there's another one by Hans Ohanian called Principles of Quantum Mechanics. That book teaches quantum mechanics both in the regular way and in the factorization way. But they didn't do everything. As an example, there was no way to find wave functions. So I knew if I was going to tackle this, there was a lot of work that had to be done to actually develop new quantum mechanical ideas using these operator-based methods. So I spent a lot of time seeing whether we could build up this method with Wes and many other people. I'm going to be showing you a number of the different papers that we worked on in the next slide, so I'm not going to go through and read all of the names of these people. We published a lot of papers. We created a course on edX. It's also the course that I teach to my undergraduate students, the undergraduate juniors. It became clear that this really could be done. So let me go through some of the different papers that we covered with this. The first was Calculating Spherical Harmonics Without Derivatives with Mark Weitzman, who had been a professional poker player, and he's a longtime learner and physics aficionado. Interestingly here, one of the hardest things I think in a quantum mechanics class is learning how to understand spherical harmonics. And in the work that we did, we were able to understand how it works just by using operators and having no differential equations. Next on the list, we showed how you can solve the particle in a box, both in a box and in a finite square well using the factorization method. Finite square well is a bit more complicated. We wrote a paper about the MOOC. At that time, we had taught it to 28,000 students. It's probably more than double that now. We wrote a course on how you can use the Stern-Gerlach experiment as a delayed choice quantum eraser and introduce that into your undergraduate physics course. We showed how you can find the wave functions of the simple harmonic oscillator completely algebraically. We wrote a paper on the Kramers-Pasternak relations, which is a way in which you can calculate expectation values of powers of R in the hydrogen atom without having to do any integrals. We showed how you actually work in spherical coordinates by converting the translation operator from Cartesian coordinates to spherical coordinates. I was shocked to learn no one had ever done this, and we published this work in 2021. I also wrote a paper on how you can determine the wave functions of squeezed coherent states. Squeezed coherent states are becoming part of the curriculum, but often people don't talk about the wave functions, and we showed here how you can talk about the wave functions. We also recognize that the free expansion of a Gaussian wave packet is actually an exercise in working with squeeze states, so we showed how you can do the free expansion using operators. We looked at the Landau-Zener problem and showed how you can do computational work on that to illustrate the properties of that model. We looked at how you can do a general operator-based formula for wave functions based off of a generalized Rodrigues formula. For those of you who know what the Rodrigues formula are, all of the special polynomials can be defined in terms of multiple derivatives acting on some function, and that's called a Rodrigues formula. And in quantum mechanics, you can generalize that using nested commutators. We also explained how, if you want to teach high school teachers how to teach quantum ideas, you better have them have a good understanding of conceptual ideas of quantum mechanics. We wrote a paper on a new way of finding the wave function of hydrogen using a Cartesian operator factorization. This works both for finding the wave function in position space and in momentum space. And that's it. Those are all the ones that I wanted to talk about. There actually are many more that I've worked on, but I just wanted to give you a sampling of the things. This is why it took 10 years to complete this project. That includes the book, the more than 150 videos that I have, and the more than 50, 60 computer-based animations that accompany the book. So I told you in the first video that nearly all quantum mechanics book copy the Schiff paradigm. Schiff's book was written in 1949. Now, if it's a modern book, it really copies Schiff, but then adds a chapter on quantum computing. That's typically what happens. So let's take a look at how Zweibach's book compares to Schiff. Now, for those of you who are not familiar with Zweibach's book, if you want to learn quantum mechanics in a conventional way, Zweibach's book is an absolutely excellent book to do this. It's a little bit tough going if you're going to be a self-studier to get yourself through chapter two, but once you're through chapter two, the rest should be fairly smooth sailing. You do have to have a very strong calculus background to be able to go through it. And as I've mentioned before, a lot of the things you learn there actually aren't things that you'll be able to use later if you go into physics-based research. So we'll start with Schiff's table of contents. There aren't that many chapters, only 13. The first is the physical basis of quantum mechanics. The second is the Schrödinger equation. The third, eigenfunctions and eigenvalues. The fourth, discrete eigenvalues, bound states. The fifth, continuous eigenvalues, collision theory. The sixth, matrix formulation of quantum mechanics. The seventh, symmetry in quantum mechanics. The eighth, approximation methods for bound states. The ninth, approximation methods in collision theory. The tenth, identical particles and spin. The 11th, atoms, molecules, and atomic nuclei. The 12th, relativistic wave equations. And the 13th, the quantization of wave fields. So we're going to now go chapter by chapter through Zweibach and see how it maps to Schiff's book. So we start off with key features of quantum mechanics. Not too surprisingly, that maps to the first chapter of Schiff. The second one is light particles and waves. Here, Zweibach actually talks about more modern experiments involving light, and so this actually doesn't map to anything in Schiff. The third one is the Schrodinger equation. That obviously maps to chapter two. The fourth is wave packets, uncertainty, and momentum space. That's actually already covered in chapter one of Schiff. Next, we have expectation values and Hermitian operators. That's also in chapter one of Schiff. Stationary states, special potentials. Well, Schiff has a chapter on stationary states, and many will fall in there, such as chapter seven also goes into that chapter. Stationary states for scattering, that goes into chapter five on collision theory. Harmonic oscillator, we're back to chapter four. Angular momentum and central potentials, this is actually covered in chapter seven on symmetry. Hydrogen atom, back to chapter four. The simplest quantum system, spin 1/2, that's covered in chapter 10, identical particles and spin. Vector spaces and operators, that's covered in symmetry and quantum mechanics. Inner products, adjoints, and brockets. Zweibach has a rather lengthy discussion of linear algebra that is not in Schiff's book, so that's one that doesn't appear in Schiff. The uncertainty principle and compatible operators. Surprisingly, Schiff doesn't really talk very much about the mathematics behind the uncertainty principle. He uses uncertainty to talk about experiments, but he doesn't really talk about the mathematics very much. The pictures of quantum mechanics, that is discussed in the matrix formulation of quantum mechanics. Dynamics of quantum systems. Interestingly, Schiff doesn't really talk very much about time dependence of quantum systems, so that's not part of it. Multiparticle states and tensor products, that's in chapter 10. Angular momentum and central potentials, that's in chapter 7. Addition of angular momentum, also in chapter 7. Identical particles, that's chapter 10. Density matrix and decoherence, that's also in chapter 10. Although not really decoherence, he talks more just about the density matrices in Schiff's book. Quantum computation, here you have the mandatory chapter on quantum computation, that's of course not in Schiff. Then we have charged particles and electromagnetic fields. This material is very similar to what appears in the 12th chapter on relativistic wave mechanics. Then we have time-dependent perturbation theory. That's in the approximation methods for bound states. We have the adiabatic approximation. Schiff doesn't talk about that. Zweibach has a very nice treatment of that as well. We have scattering in one dimension. That's in chapter 5. We have scattering in three dimensions, also chapter 5. So about 20% of Zweibach's book is different from Schiff. So now let's take a look at the table of contents for my book. I'm going to highlight in red for you all of the chapters that don't appear in Schiff. I'm not going to read through all of these. We're going to actually go through them in our set of videos, but I will actually read the ones that are in red because those are ones that are different. We talk about second quantum revolution experiments you can do with spin. We talk about the same thing with light. We have a mathematical interlude. Schiff doesn't feel it's necessary to teach any math, but because of accessibility reasons, I have to teach a little bit. We have work on using fundamental operator identities. That's not an emphasis in Schiff. We have the Ising and XY models of interacting spins. I don't know why this isn't part of the quantum curriculum after you learn about angular momentum, but you won't find pretty much any quantum textbook that will talk about that. I then have a mathematical interlude again on advanced properties of matrices. We talk about exchange and the Heisenberg model, another advanced topic that doesn't make it into most quantum mechanics books. We talk about the Hubbard model. This is one of the workhorses of strongly correlated materials in condensed matter physics. I talk about real applications to chemistry, including things like coupled cluster calculations. My quantum simulation or quantum computing chapter is quantum simulation with trapped ions. It's very different from those that you'll find in other textbooks. I talk about decoherence and squeeze states, in particular why squeeze states are needed to make LIGO work better. And then I end with a chapter that talks about how you do measurement on single quanta. And here's where we really focus on the second quantum revolution. So about half of my book is different from Schiff's. So I hope that gives you an idea about why this work is really quite different. It reflects much of the coverage of new quantum mechanics that has developed since 1949. And hey guys, let's do quantum right.